This book haul is so overwhelming. I didn't even want to move the books to me. I moved to the books. What's up? It's Jan, back at it again with another nerdy bookish video. This is going to be a collective fall book haul. Alright everybody, I'm gonna do my disclaimers that I've been doing for every book haul. It's my money, I can do what I want. But also half of these are gifts, to be honest, because Joey's friend gave me a massive gift card to Barnes & Noble as well as Amazon, but also a bunch of my patrons have been oh so kind and gifted me some congratulations gifts for hitting 11,000 subscribers, so thank you to everyone, but extra thank you to those patrons who sent me gifts for that or for anything, to be honest. Y'all don't have to get me anything, like literally your support, just being here watching my stuff already means the world. But thank you so much to anyone who has ever gotten me gifts from my wish list or anything. But yeah, I did count at one point and then I accumulated more books and I lost count, so we're just not going to talk about numbers. These two piles are pretty much all gifts. Well, there's some mixed in there that were purchased by me, but yeah, gifts from Aardvark, gifts from some authors, gifts bought with those gift cards, and like I said, from patrons. So regardless, my money is my money. I can do what I want. Please mind your business. Don't watch this if it bothers you that there are a lot of books in this haul. Also, another disclaimer, I am not here to provide a verbatim word by word, that's redundant, full blown synopsis for each of these books, or else we'll be here until tomorrow. Google is free. This is my merch, link down below. But Google is free, and guess what? So is Goodreads. When I do my book hauls, I usually just talk about buzzwords that got me interested in it, who got it for me, why I wanted to pick this book up, and then I give a brief synopsis. I do always start with gifts in my book hauls because I like to express gratitude first and foremost. We're gonna start with Aardvark Book Club because I love them so much and they've been sending me books monthly pretty much all year, and I just love promoting them. I love working with them. I love their selections every month. There's always something for everybody. All their picks are always so diverse, and I do have a discount code JAN to get your first box for $4 and free shipping. The books aren't even in here, so I don't know what I'm doing. Where are they? Oh my god. I know I'm not gonna get them all at once because clearly I'm not organized whatsoever. There are also some in that pile, so we're just gonna start with these three. These weren't even all in the same box, but we have The City in Glass by Nevo. I'm so excited to read this because it's short. I think this is gonna be the Nevo that really hits for me because I've read a few of their works before. I've read Siren Queen and the first two books in that novella series, Empress of Salt and Fortune. Their writing goes over my head sometimes, most of the time, but I enjoy it while I'm reading it, if that makes sense, because it flows well and it's gorgeous. This is a standalone. I love standalones, like short fantasies. I think this is my like bread and butter, short fantasies and short horror, but only if they pack that punch that I want. But anyway, this says a demon, an angel, and a city, and that's all I needed. But I see the word immortal, which is one of my favorite tropes. Immortality is one of my favorite tropes. But it says The City in Glass is both a brilliantly constructed history and an epic love story of death and resurrection, memory and transformation, redemption and desire strong enough to reduce a world to ashes and remake it anew. So excited for this. I definitely want to read this fairly soon. If I can squeeze it into this year, that would be grand, but it feels like a winter book. I don't know why. It just feels like a book I'll enjoy in the winter. The next book I have already read, and I actually got it personalized. This is So Thirsty by Rachel Harrison. I read an e-arc of this and then Aardvark had it as an option, and I do have all of Rachel Harrison's books. I didn't want to pass this up, and I went to a Rachel Harrison event and got it signed. Like I said, it was already signed because Aardvark also has signed editions sometimes, but it was so nice meeting Rachel Harrison. So this is also like a sentimental book for me because it was the So Thirsty tour. I didn't really like this one, to be honest. I gave it 2 stars, but I would be willing to reread it because there were parts that I did really like, and I like the themes of like aging and everything else that Rachel Harrison talked about at the event. I really loved Alice. She was my favorite character in this. It's a vampire story and there's a friendship in there. I kept saying it wasn't as toxic as I wanted it to be. It is toxic. It's just not like I wanted them to turn into vampires and basically want to slit each other's throats, but that's not the type of toxic friendship we got. That's my thing. I don't know. There was something about this that just didn't hit for me, but everything else by Rachel Harrison was 4 or 5 stars for me. But I would still try this if you
are even remotely interested.
Next, we have This Cursed House by Del Sandine. I have been recently burnt out by haunted house books, but I know there's going to be a point next year that I'm going to want to read. Honestly, Winterween, it's haunted house themed, and there's a house in the title and the cover prompt, so honestly, I might read this for Winterween in January. This is a Southern Gothic horror, and it's a debut. It's about a young Black woman who abandons her life in 1960s Chicago for a position with a mysterious family in New Orleans, only to discover the dark truth. They're under a curse and they think she can break it. Love a good curse. Don't love a book set in Chicago, but I will make the exception for this book because look how good this cover is. I love a black and white cover with a pop of color. I'm just gonna go into some of the books that were from Joey's friend, either if he sent them to me. He sends Joey gifts too, okay? Or if I bought them with the gift card. First thing in the pile is The Book of Elsewhere by Keanu Reeves and China Miavi. I don't know. I'm sorry if I butchered. Ooh, I love the back. Oh, I thought S.T. Gibson blurbed it. It's William Gibson. Anyway, so funny story behind this is I would always see the spine and I'd always pull it out of Half Price Books, just forgetting that it's by Keanu Reeves. And I'm not one, unless it's a memoir, I'm not one to pick up books by celebrities. It's like a crossover that I don't like when it comes to fiction books, at least. I would always pull it out of the shelves at bookstores and I'd be like, oh my God, because it's hot pink, so it always catches my eye. And then so it became this like running joke. And then I would see it everywhere. Anywhere books are sold, it's there as a face out even. And I would always send Joey a picture for everything. Like even at my library, it's a face out. So I put it on my wish list because it does sound kind of interesting. A mind-blowing epic, unlike anything these two genre-bending pioneers have created before, inspired by the world of the Berserker comic books. I don't know why that sounded interesting to me. The synopsis sounds like a fun time. I put it on my wish list and then Joey's friend got it for me. It just showed up. I was like, oh my God. We laughed so hard. I need to stop going like in depth for all of these. He also sent me all the Bridgerton books. I have the first one. I bought the first one myself. Joey and I watched Bridgerton together. Joey texted him and was like, oh my God, Jan said these books disappeared from her wish list. And he's like, oh yeah, I just thought they looked cool with the contrasting colors and stuff. And I'm like, yeah, checks out, because I didn't think he intentionally bought Bridgerton books, you know? I'm excited. I love Bridgerton. Queen Charlotte was my favorite season. I know it's not a season, but I like Queen Charlotte the best. I think my ranking would be Queen Charlotte, season 2, then season 1, and then season 3. Yeah, so I have lots of options for when I'm missing Bridgerton whilst awaiting the next season. Also, with the Barnes & Noble gift card, I bought Blood Over Bright Haven by M.L. Wong. I heard about this from Steph originally, and then it got traditionally published, so it wasn't available. One of my patrons, M, raved about it in our Discord, and I was like, okay, you sold me. It's dark academia, I believe. Oh, and it's a standalone. That's another thing. I love a standalone fantasy. Like, that's a buzzword for me. Dark fantasy. Isn't there a university? Yeah, at the University of Magics and Industry, there's a bunch of magic. It's just such a pretty book. Wait, is this the book that I heard it wasn't too complicated to understand? It says, the first woman ever admitted to a prestigious order of mages unravels a secret conspiracy that could change the practice of magic forever. I'm excited. I hope my BB brain can handle this one. I believe I bought Sally's Lament with the gift card as well. I loved Long Live the Pumpkin Queen. I just wanted another Sally book. Oh, I just love the cover. I know this is part of the Twisted Tale series and it's like a Disney spin-off series and each book is by a different author. So you don't have to read them in order, thankfully, because I haven't read any of them, but I know there's a bunch of them. So I'm glad they finally made a spooky-ish one because all the other ones are mostly like Disney princesses, I think, which I am still interested in, honestly. I think I started the first book in the series, but yeah, I'm definitely gonna skip over to this one because the cover is so eerie and I love Nightmare Before Christmas. I do. I can't lie. Oh Lord. Okay, these just came in the mail yesterday. With a gift card, I got The Wedding Witch by Erin Sterling. I was so confused about the fact that this wasn't a Book of the Month pick because the other two I have as Book of the Month editions, and I resisted buying this when I was physically in the store when I was filming my Ultimate Book video because I thought it would be on Book of the Month, but alas, it's not. This is the third book in, I don't even know what the series name is, but first two books are The X-Hex and The Kiss Curse, and I loved both of those books. Y'all know I don't usually gravitate towards Christmas romances, but this year, something about them is just calling my name. I don't know. Like this and Nightmare Before Christmas, which is also in this haul. Who does this follow? Bowen and Tamsin. I don't remember who they are in relation to the characters in the first two books, but it's set in the same small town and it's a Christmas romance. So I'm gonna put this in my next Keep It or Kick It video if it goes up after this. I don't even know. Who knows when this video will go up, to be honest. Another green book that I got. This Will Be Fun by E.B. Asher. culture. So I actually heard about this just because it was an option on the Libro FM ALC books. So I do have the audiobook. I saw it compared to Shrek. Main female character's name is Elowen, which is the same name as in Fear of the Flames, which I loved. This just sounds like so much fun. Former friends, former flames, a mayhem spiked quest. What could go wrong? Anything compared to Shrek, I just pick up instantly. I heard was it the Hanging City or the Hanging Castle? I think it's the Hanging City. That was pitched as Shrek to me and I immediately added it to KU. Have I read it yet? No, but that doesn't matter. No one asked. But yeah, it just sounds like a cozy fun time. Look at the cover. It's so cute. Since I did mention it, here's The Nightmare Before Christmas. It is just the cutest cover. I actually have a NetGalley arc for this, but I saw the red sprayed edges. I saw the cover. The little jack-o'-lantern gets me every time. And like the embossed lettering, I just had to. Also, tell me that's not the same artist as some of Ali Hazelwood's books. Like that looks like an identical art style, no? Tell me. Tell them. This is a male-male romance, and it's a reimagining of The Nightmare Before Christmas, obviously. I thought about doing like a Nightmare Before Christmas themed vlog with Sally's Lament and this, and then watching the movie or whatever, but like, I feel like that's just too much. I don't know. But it says, get ready for the sexy, quirky rom-com where the golden-hearted prince of Christmas falls for the totally off-limits prince of Halloween. Like, how fun does that sound? Yeah, I think I'm gonna read this in December because that just feels right. And it'll up my NetGalley score when I review it. I know that's not the point, but like, I just want my score to go up. Also sent me It by Stephen King. I believe Joey probably told him we were watching both movies and that they're good, and I thought they were good. I don't know, but this disappeared off my wish list and it's so floppy. Now I have no excuse to not read it. So one day, I will break this up in itty bitty pieces and finish it within, I don't know, a few months probably. But yeah, I did really like the film adaptations, the remakes. I haven't seen the original just yet, but I watched It and It Chapter 2 and I love both of them. The Stephen King cameo in the second one, dead. If you saw my ultimate book video, some of these I did purchase in that video, including Nightmare Before Christmas, actually, but I couldn't resist The Stars Are Dying by Chloe C. Penuranda. Just, again, I have a NetGalley arc of this, but I hate reading fantasies on my Kindle. Who could resist this freaking copy? And then I was like, okay, Jan, be realistic. Let's read the first couple sentences and see if the writing is even your vibe. And it was. I read the first couple sentences in that Ultimate Book video, so I'll link that down below, but this is gorgeous. It says, 500 years ago, something changed. Everyone felt it, like the world was cracking, like something had stepped into the realm that was never supposed to be here. I think everyone knew the Golden Age, the Star Maiden had ushered in was about to be shaken like the stars that began to die out. It just seems like it's gonna have that flowery writing that I crave sometimes. So when that mood hits, I have this. And then I got Delilah S. Dawson's new book, It Will Only Hurt for a Moment. This seems like it's culty, but I could be wrong. It also seems like it's about this woman who's like trying to find herself again or like reinvent herself. It says, this place, it's everything she hoped it would be, wide open and thoughtful and artfully beautiful, like it was made just for her. Closing her eyes, she makes a silent wish. Please let this place rebuild me. Let me discover myself or rediscover myself. Let there be something left. Like, I just think that's beautiful. I love Delilah S. Dawson's book so far. I have Guillotine in this haul, which I gave 5 stars, and then I also read Bloom this year, which I gave 4 stars. She's on a roll with me, and hopefully this doesn't break the streak. Joey's friend also sent me Wild Eyes by Elsie Silver. Again, he just chose the first few things that were at the top of my wish list. Actually so excited for this, even though I haven't read a damn Elsie Silver book yet. But I have the entire Chestnut Spring series, I have Wild Love, and now I have Wild Eyes, and I'm so excited to see this all come together with the spines. And the third one, what's called Wild Side, and it's like a bright green. Oh, they're gonna look so pretty together, even though I probably won't keep them together because they're all very different colors. But this is part of the spin-off of the Chestnut Spring series. This is the Rose Hill series. I don't know the tropes in this book. It says, day one, she ran full tilt into the world's hottest single dad trope, and now all her plans are ruined. Of course, his name is Weston. A lot of these small town romances have a dude named West or Weston or Wes. I will read an Elsie Silver very soon. I don't know how soon, but very soon. I took a Patreon poll to vote on which one I should read first, because I also have her debut series, because that just got new covers. And they, of course, chose Flawless, so I will be reading Flawless as my first Elsie Silver book. Surprise, surprise. I just don't know when, but stay tuned. Speaking of, he also got me a Photo Finish, which is the sequel to the first book, which was, what's it called? Off to the Races. And this is the Gold Rush Ranch series. So this is another cowboy series. phase. And y'all know I had that phase over the summer where that was like my entire vibe. And we're gonna go back to that, okay? Just not right now. This one I actually already read my NetGalley arc for. I know, hold the applause. Lucy and Dying by Kirsten White. I'm so glad he sent me this because literally it was the day after I finished my arc of it and I gave it 4 stars. And y'all know I love Dracula, okay? So this was just exactly what I wanted from a Dracula reimagining, except the parts that dragged. It is a little bit too long for what it was, and the reveals were kind of weird. It was kind of a little too modern for my liking, but the past timelines and the whole gothic vibes and the Dracula vibes, they were well done. I do highly recommend reading Dracula before jumping into this one because it does really help and enhance the reading experience. This follows Lucy and it follows Iris, who's in the modern timeline, and then we go back and forth. The chapters are really short. It's mixed media, kind of, I think. There are like transcripts and stuff, and I believe some articles, journal entries. Dracula is an epistolary novel, so it just makes sense that this one is kind of in the same format. I really enjoyed this one. There are some side characters that made me laugh out loud, and it's sapphic, so there's that. If you love vampires, if you love Dracula, do read this. All right, 2 more from this gift card / Joey's friend situation. I'm Fucking Amazing by Anushka Warden. It did come damaged, which is really annoying, and this is one of those unapologetic lit fics. It's about a woman in her 30s. She's having some sexual issues, some body issues. It says sexually frank, wildly funny, psychologically raw, and it's a debut, and it says perfect for fans of Fleabag, which Joey and I did start watching. I don't know if we ever finished it. I think he did, per the recommendation of 2 of my patrons, Tiffany and Megan, who love Fleabag. So I'm excited for this, and I actually gifted Tiffany this too, so maybe we could buddy read it one day. I suck at buddy reads though. Anyway, the last thing I bought with the Amazon gift card, I also still have like 20 bucks left on that Barnes & Noble gift card, so I will be using that next time I need some retail therapy. But I got Now Comes the Mist by Julie C. Dow. This is another vampire book, and it's by an Asian author. There are very few Asian vampire stories out there, so I jumped on this as soon as I heard it came out. Oh, it's also a Dracula reimagining. I knew that. And it also follows Lucy. Okay, cool, cool, cool. So that's all I needed to know. I just don't like how tall this paperback is. It's one of those, it feels like an arc. And what is this? Why is the spacing so non-existent? But yeah, I've heard good things about this so far. I'm excited. It says this novel will leave you breathless. I'm so excited for this. I don't know about this cover. I mean, it's gorgeous, but like there's something about the way it's arranged. I don't know, but I'm loving these blood drips. Okay, other gift. Oh, here are the 2 aardvark books that weren't at the top of the pile. A Dark and Drowning Tide by Allison Saft. I actually DNF'd Down Comes the Night by Allison Saft, so I haven't tried her again since, but I've heard really good things about this. This is a sapphic, gothic, dark academia. I believe they're academic rivals. Is that right? Or am I just making that up? And one of the main characters' names is Lorelai. They're rivals, right? Or did I make that up? I think I made that up, actually. Lorelai's a folklorist. That's pretty cool. She's trying to prove herself to become a naturalist. Her mentor is murdered. Then Sylvia comes in and they go on this expedition to investigate the murder, I believe. Okay, yeah, dark academia fantasy perfection. Oh, I just love how matte aardvark books are. And this cover, that just screams gothic to me. Speaking of gothic covers, Lady Macbeth by Ava Reed. I am not a Shakespeare girly, but I am really excited for this. I really enjoyed A Study in Drowning. The way Ava Reed writes is just so lyrical, but also easy to read, like easy to digest. I don't know. So I actually heard that if you've read Macbeth, it actually hinders your experience with this because there are some inaccuracies. I'm not sure. I don't know. I'm just the messenger. I don't remember much about Macbeth if I did read it in high school. I know I read A Midsummer Night's Dream. It's a reimagining of Lady Macbeth, giving her a voice, a past, and a power that transforms the story men have written for her. Just that is just such a powerful statement. I'm just excited for the feminist commentary in this. I'm sure there will be some. Okay, let's get into gifts from my vampies. This one is from Shay from Press Play Shay. I will link her channel down below. She sent me A Witch's Guide to Fake Dating a Demon. She said this was on my wish list for long enough and that it was a fun time when she read it. It just sounds like a witchy fun time. Shay also sent a beautiful Lair Care package that arrived on Halloween and it was just a whole moment. It really made the holiday for me. But this also came the night before. It says, Marielle knows not to trust a demon, especially one who wants her soul. But what's a witch to do when he won't leave her side, and she kind of doesn't want him to. I know a lot of people are reading this series, but I haven't really heard too many strong opinions, positive or negative, with this, so I'm interested to see where I stand. Okay, you've heard me talk about her before, but Destiny has sent me 3 books as a thank you for the lair. Let me just read the note. Here's to another year in the lair. This one says, October 11th is the 2-year anniversary since joining the lair. The lair has gotten me through some tough times, and I am so thankful for all that you do. I so appreciate you. And I appreciate you too, Destiny. I appreciate the lair so much. I can't get into it too much or else I'll get emotional. And again, we'll be here till tomorrow. Let's just get into The Familiar, which is standing at my number one of the year so far. And I did buy myself a special edition as well. I'll show y'all later. But I read my Book of the Month edition for my Do Your Worst episode 7. So I'll link that vlog down below. If you like The Invisible Life of Addie LaRue, please read this. I just want to gush about it with more people. I loved it so much. I love the romance in it. It's like so subtle, so slow burn, and just so well done, mixed with the fantasy, with the trials, with the Faustian bargain, which is one of my favorite tropes of all time. And it has the same themes as Addie LaRue, like I said. So really, really good. Deserves all the hype, honestly. And I wish I read it sooner this year, but I just read it last month. Another one I already read is The Hitchcock Hotel by Stephanie Roble. I read this for one of our Lair readathons, and I gave this 5 stars. This is one of my favorite thrillers of all time now. This is also a contender for my top 10 of the year. Why am I feeling deja vu? Why am I feeling deja vu? Did I just talk about this book? I literally feel like I just talked about this book the other day. Oh my god. Okay. This is about a dude who is a huge Alfred Hitchcock fan. I love The Birds by Alfred Hitchcock. He sets up a hotel that's Hitchcock themed, and this is chock full of Alfred Hitchcock facts and references and quotes. He invites 6 college friends who know something that happened during your senior year. So you find out about that. There's a murder, of course. It wasn't like the twistiest thing you'll ever read if you're very well versed in thrillers, but just the way it was all set up and how distinct each of the characters are. Why does it feel like I just read? Oh, because I filmed my wrap up the other day. Oh my god. Okay. Myth debunked, problem solved. Sorry. Like I said in my wrap up, I don't know if that's going up before or after this, but it was a little bit predictable and there was a villain monologue, but it was in the person's head versus out loud. And this book made me realize the difference of why I liked this versus other villain monologues. Really enjoyed this. I don't want to give too much away. It was riveting. I was flying through these pages. Loved it. And then she also got me Near to the Wild Heart by Clarice Lispector. I was unaware that Clarice Lispector is a Brazilian author. I knew her books were translated, but I didn't know from what language. Now I know. Clarice Lispector, I never even heard of until I watched Leah Crumpton's vlogs. I just know this has really good writing. I know all her books have really good writing. I kind of want to go into this blind. I don't even know how I heard about this book. I don't know why I added it to my wish list, but I'm glad I have it because it's my first book by this author and it's short. Where is the synopsis? Oh, Hurricane Clarice, an unknown 23-year-old who wrote her first book in a tiny rented room. Hold on, that's a bio. Yeah, I don't know, couldn't tell you, but thank you, Destiny, for all your gifts and all your generosity and all your support. I cannot thank you enough. The most recent gifts from Vamps that I got are more congratulations gifts, and Amanda sent me The Har by David Sondergren, as well as Arrival Most Vile. This is on Kindle Unlimited, and I had it on my Kindle, but I was like, I feel like I'm gonna love this so much, I'm gonna want a physical copy to annotate. And I loved Maggie's Grave by David Sondergren. I just love his writing. There's something about it that's just so kind of comforting in a way, like cozy. But I heard this was really, really sad for a horror book. I know Gabby really loves this book as well. A lot of my patrons love this book. I just kind of want to go into it blindly. All I need to know is it's one of those sad horror books and I'm gonna enjoy the writing because it's David Sondergren. So thank you, Amanda, for this. This one, I know my friend Kitty really loved it, and it's a cozy, is it witchy? 2 potion shops, 1 heated rivalry until hate bubbles over into something else. So there's a romance in it, and they're rivals, obviously. Any adventurer worth their sword knows about Ambrose Beak. Proud, quiet, half-elf sells the best and only potions in the city until a handsome new shopkeeper named Eli opens another shop across the street, throwing Ambrose's peace and ledgers far off balance. Oh my god, is it male-male romance? I didn't even know that! Oh my god, I'm extra excited. Beautiful. Gorgeous. The next 2 are from Jamie from Canada. She also kindly sent me Haunted Ever After by Jen DeLuca, as well as episode 13 by Craig DeLuey. Oh my god, DeLuca, DeLuey? Did you do that on purpose? But this was another one that was on my Kindle, but I would always feel the paperback and I'm like, oh my god, it's mixed media. It's gonna go by quick. I'm gonna wanna flip the pages. So I just tacked it onto my wishlist for me to remember to buy it when I do get in the mood to read it. But I've read Suffer the Children by this author and kind of hated it. So I'm interested to give them a second chance because I've heard this one gets really creepy and it's in epistolary format, which I love. But I think this is, yeah, found footage when a reality TV show's crew find themselves trapped in a nightmare of their own creation. I was at Barnes & Noble one day and the bookseller said that this is one of the scariest books that he sells to people, and he always tells the story of this one customer who returned it a couple of days after buying it because they said that it was too scary. I don't know, maybe it was just someone who wasn't, you know, into the horror genre regularly, but we'll see. I'll be the judge of that for myself. And then this is like a haunted little town, I think, in Florida, and the guy is a grumpy coffee shop owner. The girl moves there, I think. It's a seaside town, and I don't usually like books that are set in this type of setting, but give me a ghost, give me a coffee shop owner, and we're set. The next two are from an IRL friend who's also a patron, actually. So thank you, Tatsu, for getting me these two books that she did ask me to read and review. They're not books that I would usually go for. Well, I do love a good memoir, so I don't know what I'm talking about. But this is by Blake Martin. This is actually written by one of Tatsu's friends. It's always wild to me when people I know or indirectly know have gotten books, you know, written and published, even if it's indie published. But this seems like it'll get really heavy. I feel like I need to be in a really good headspace to handle this. Called Baggage Claim. On the back, he talks about what his baggage is. I really like that title. I love wordplay. But yeah, it says stories of unpacking the baggage of childhood trauma, rape, abandonment, and suicide. So lots of triggers for this one, but it'd be cool to read a memoir from someone I kind of know, you know? I guess I don't know him at all, but Tatsu does so. Anyway, Dead Air. All she told me is that there's a satanic cult involved, and it's a really old book. It has that like vintage font, you know? So I'm intrigued to see why she loved it so much. And again, it's not something I gravitate towards because it is such a backlisted book. I mean, I love my backlist books, but I usually don't go too far back unless they're like classics. This is 1991. A young girl is kidnapped by a secret cult and only one man can help her. Will he be able to face the fury of the Dark Raven? I don't know what that means. I guess we'll find out. And then I have a couple books from authors. This one is Cruel Nature by DB Albiza, and they sent me a bookmark with it as well. This is actually a middle grade. Does that look like a middle grade to you? Me neither. Seven Terrifying Tales to Trouble Your Sleep. There are illustrations in this. This reminds me of like an extreme horror. Excuse me? Like Joey has these types of smaller books called Pocket Atrocities. This reminds me of that. It seems very creepy for a middle grade. Perfect for spooky season if you're still celebrating, like me. And then I have Schroeder by Neil Cassidy. It says, when an ordinary young man wakes up in his quiet neighborhood on a day seemingly like all the others, the city he's lived in all his life has no idea what's about to befall it once he sets out on a day-long bike ride carrying a purposefully packed backpack and a definitive plan. Who is Schroeder and what motivates his brutal killing spree? All I need. Love a book from the POV of a serial killer. Seems intense. And I love supporting indie authors. They sent me a handwritten note. Like, how amazing is that? I forgot to show these two from patrons as well. I don't know where I put the other one, but a Stillbe got me the first two volumes in this series, the Midnight Children series, hashtag DRCL, another Dracula reimagining. What can I say? The vamps know my brand. And she said, you're amazing and the most stunning vampy queen, and I'm so thankful for the safe community you've made. And that just like warms my heart every time anyone calls the lair a safe space or my channel a safe space. It's just so, I don't know. Like, I mean, I created it, but they, you know, make it a safe space and a safe community. And it just like truly makes my soul and heart happy. And I could cry. Especially in this day and age, you know, and nowadays and in this current climate. Whew! Okay. She also got me volume 2, like I said, as well as another spooky cute coloring book that I've been working on. So really love it. This is a manga series, by the way, and I love the art style in this. Again, definitely recommend reading Dracula first so you can have the full, well-rounded experience. I mentioned her earlier, but Tiffany got me Beach Read by Emily Henry, the deluxe edition that says, I feel overwhelmed that you exist on the front, the sunset. She pre-ordered this. So this was back when I hit 9k. Congratulations on 9k, catching up on uploads and all the wonderful collabs. I know March was a hard month and I hope things only go up from here. It's an honor to call you a friend. On to 10k. And now we're at 11k. Like, how fucking wild. I'm just really in my feels today. I'm sorry. Beach Read is my favorite Emily Henry book. I've read it twice. I've cried twice. I love it so much. This is a gorgeous, gorgeous edition. And on the back it says, when the world felt dark and scary, love could whisk you off to go dancing. Laughter could take some of the pain away. Beauty could punch holes in your fear. And it's in cursive, and then there are the little flowers. Oh my god, I love this. I love this so, so much. Thank you, Tiffany. Oh, my sprints are done. The last two gifted books before we get into the books I spent my monies on are Evil in Me by Brom, and this was sent to me by Tor Nightfire. I loved Slewfoot, so I was so ecstatic when they offered to send me this one. This just feels like the ultimate grunge book, you know what I mean? And Brom's art is just stellar. Like, how fucking creepy. There's an aspiring musician, and it's set in the 80s Atlanta punk scene. And it seems like there's some religious horror in this. It'd be an interesting time. Like, look at this cover, though. It's so, like, I don't know, trippy. I guess that's the right word for it. Is that what the cool kids say? And then we have The Songbird and the Heart of Stone. Have I read a Carissa Broadbent yet? No, but thank you to the publisher for sending me this anyway. I own 4, 5 of her books, 6 of her books now, and I will get to them. Next year will be the year. I didn't realize this was a spinoff. I thought this was like the next book in the Serpent and the Wings of Night, I guess, series, but it is still in the Crowns of Nyaxio world, but it's a new duology, if that makes sense. In The Descent to the Underworld, a bride of the sun must choose between the light of her redemption or a dark love that defies the gods themselves. I love a good, difficult decision in a book. That always makes it somewhat of a fun time. So I am excited for this. I just need to read the others first. I'm just intimidated by Carissa Broadbent. I don't know. And part of it is that I know I'm gonna love Serpent in the Wings of Night because no one has told me otherwise. But that just makes me want to read Daughter of No Worlds first because I want an uphill experience. You know, I don't want to go from like up here and then go to Daughter of No Worlds. But who knows? Maybe I'll love them all. Who knows? So let's go to the books I purchased for myself. First up, I got this from Pingo. No, I didn't. I got this from Barnes & Noble. Model Home by River Solomon. I went back and forth so many times with buying this, getting it from the library, trying to wait for the long ass hold. And then Tiffany read it. I'm always influenced by Tiffany. She read it and she loved it. And she's like, you're gonna want to annotate this. So of course I added to cart. I had a Barnes & Noble reward, I believe. So it worked out. This is by River Solomon, who wrote Sorrowland and The Deep, which I read and love. I haven't read An Unkindness of Ghosts yet, or whatever it's called. I heard that one's more sci-fi and I probably won't like it. But this one is like a haunted house type of situation, but I think the family is haunted. Ooh, a demonic rite of passage. Tiffany said there's like a gated community, and I just read We Came to Welcome You, and she said there are similarities, so I'm excited. I gave We Came to Welcome You 5 stars, so hopefully this delivers. But again, I am burnt out on the haunted house trope for now, so I will be saving this until that changes. Next we have a Western horror, which is a genre I've never read before. This is Red Rabbit by Alex Grecian, and I think they have another book coming out in the same world or with the same characters or whatever. I just got an email about it. This is also by Tor Nightfire, so I have high hopes. It says, saddle up, it's gonna be a bloody ride. Sadie Grace is wanted for witchcraft, and every hired gun in Kansas is out to collect the bounty on her head, including bona fide witch hunter Old Tom and his mysterious mute ward Rabbit. They're joined by 2 vagabond cowboys. It just sounds like an adventure, and I'm here for it. I've never read a Western, I don't think. I think the closest I've read to a Western was Vampires of El Norte by Isabel Cañas, but this has witches in it too, so hopefully it's good. Oh, I was like, why are the chapters so long? But it's like one of those where they're like in parts and the chapters restart. I've never heard anybody talk about this, so I'm going into this as blindly as possible. Next we have Woodworm by Layla Martinez, and I've heard really good things about this. I had this from the library for weeks, and I just kept putting it off because I'm like, I'm gonna wanna annotate this. I'm gonna wanna buy this. So I did. After Destiny actually read it and was like, I think you're gonna wanna annotate it. Maybe try it from the library first, but like, I think you're gonna want to. So that's all I needed. I found it on Pango for cheaper than regular retail price. And I love the cover. I love when the image is on the naked cover and there's no dust jacket. But this is another haunted slash sentient house situation. And I think there's commentary on immigration and generational trauma and maybe grief too. But this is a translated work as well. And it's a short horror, which has been working for me this year very well, if I do say so myself. I guess we can go to Book of the Month books since there are so many. Oh god, there's more behind me. So let's just talk about my Lair Bloody Read as well as my Full Moon Book Club pick. These two are voted on by my patrons, so I will be reading both these books in November and have spoiler-filled reading vlogs. Obviously, the Bloody Read is going to be Patreon only, but the Book of Witching vlog will be up on YouTube on the full moon, which is November 15th. A mother must fight for her daughter's life in this fierce and haunting tale of witchcraft and revenge. And I feel like this is going to have some of the same themes slash vibes as Wayward by, I forgot the author, but it was another Full Moon Book Club pick, and it also had a crow on the cover, or a raven. I don't know, there's something with their their beaks that's different. I just saw like a side-by-side comparison and I keep getting it mixed up in my head. All you bird enthusiasts are gonna correct me. Please don't come after me. But they both have birds on the cover. Both have witches. So hopefully this one is better. But I've heard not good things about this one so far. So I'm nervous. Hopefully it's at least better than Wayward. Ooh, that was my stomach. The Bog Wife says, the Hadley siblings of West Virginia unearth long buried secrets when the supernatural bargain entwining their fate with their ancestral land is suddenly ruptured. Supernatural bargain. I don't know what that means. I hope that means like Faustian bargain. I mean, what else could it be, right? That's again, one of my favorite tropes. So I'm really excited for this. I just got my November book of the month box yesterday. So we'll share this. This is my biggest. I have 5 books for this box. I don't know what made me go all out, but this, I believe, was the actual pick. Pictures of You by Emma Gray. It says, what would you do if you could start over? Imagine having a second chance with the one you never forgot. And I love a good second chance romance. This has memory loss, which is like the most scary thing for me. I have a good feeling about this. I feel like I'm gonna cry, most likely. So maybe I'll read this before the end of the year to check off my book of the month challenge, question mark. I don't know, we'll see. Then I have The Courting of Bristol Keats, which seems so good and like whimsical. There's Dangerous Bay, Dark Secrets, and Addictive Romance. And the chapters are so short, so even though it's a big book, I feel like I'd fly through this. And this is by Mary E. Pearson, who wrote The Kiss of Deception, which I haven't read, but I do own. The spine is so pretty. The Addictive Romance and The Dangerous Bay. Anything with Fae, I'm like inclined to pick up for some reason, but in reality, when was the last time I read about Fae? Oh, the only purple house in town had Fae. That was fairly recent. Fairly recent. Everything that says Fae, I'm just like, I immediately want to get it. I don't know why. So yeah, love this cover. Hopefully I love this book. Next we have a book that I chose because it's Gabby's book troop pick for December. Kill for Me, Kill for You. I was gonna get it from the library, but I feel like this is something Joey would want to read as well. And it says Hitchcockian and heart-racing psychological thriller. So I feel like I'd love this enough to want it on my shelves. I don't have too many thrillers on my shelves other than from Book of the Month. So I feel like this is gonna hit, and Gabby really liked it, so hopefully I do too. I know sometimes our taste doesn't align, but two strangers meet by chance and then they come up with a plan that they like kill for each other. Beats me, but hopefully I do read this and get to go to the book troop live show whenever it comes around. Or no, this was my pick. Dirty Diana by Jen Besser and Shayna Fest. A provocative novel about being caught between marriage and memories of a more sensual past. The first of a 3-part series based on the number one fiction podcast. What? Fiction podcast? I didn't even know those were a thing. The first of a 3-part series. I didn't know this was a series. But it seems like very Sally Rooney-esque. It feels like it's gonna talk a lot about like marriage and love. I don't know. I love reading about love. But it says provocative. So I feel like it's just gonna be like unapologetically like blunt and raw and honest. So maybe I'll get to this pretty soon too. Pretty short. And then for the first time that I've seen, Book of the Month did Stenciled Edges. This is Bloodguard by CC Robson. I actually saw this as an Amazon suggestion like last year, and I had it on my wish list ever since, and I always forget that it's even a thing. I saw it on Book of the Month, and you had to pay like $1 extra to get this edition, and they sold out. Good thing I had it in my cart, because I went to click on it and it says sold out, but I was like, wait, it's already in my cart. So I got it. And they have end pages, which never happens for Book of the Month. It's the same one on the back and the front. And then on the back it says, enter the arena, seize 2 weapons, now try to survive. So it sounds kind of Hunger Games but like way more intense. 100 years, tens of thousands of gladiators, and today only one will rise. Everything in the kingdom of Arrow is a lie. I feel like it's Hunger Games, but make it gladiators. I'm in no rush to get to this one. I'm just glad I got this edition from Book of the Month and I didn't have to pay $32 for it. Speaking of special editions, this is probably one of my favorite special editions that I've gotten this year, if not ever, with The Dagger in the Flame by Catherine Doyle. This is also a Book of the Month pick, but I found the Fairy Loot edition on Pango. Yeah, good choice, Jan. I know. Thank you very much. Literal knife to throat. And I heard this is Enemies to Lovers, if it weren't obvious already. And there's the back. And I heard the writing style is pretty YA at times, but once you get used to it, it gets good. So I think there are two enemy guilds, the Cloaks and the Daggers, the Thieves and the Assassins. The love interest is Ransom, heir to the Order of Daggers. I have been eyeing this book and I really want to start it like really soon. Back to speaking of Fae, I got Arrival Rivalry of Hearts by Tessonia Odette. This just screams Divine Rivals meets Bridgerton. I just made that comp myself, but it says two rival writers, one prestigious publishing contract, a bargain of hearts, and seduction. It's those two things, but make it fae. Literally, there's a character named Edwina in it, which is one of the characters in season two of Bridgerton, so tell me that's not a correct assumption. I think I saw this on Bookstagram while scrolling for work, and I bought it immediately. It seems fun. Fingers crossed. Another Delilah S. Dawson book, The Violence. This is a very, very big thriller about a pandemic, I think? Epidemic of violence. Is this the one that only men are infected? Or no, it's just anyone. Anyone who's infected with the violence, they just go on like a rage, violent rage of just anger and hatred. And it seems fucking scary. It sucks that the Pango seller didn't indicate that it's a library copy. It's from the Los Angeles Public Library, so that's great. But it's okay, it wasn't expensive at all, whatever. But this is a backlisted book, and I hope it's able to hold my attention for this long of a freaking thriller. The next one I bought from my favorite horror bookstore that I took Gabby and Rachel to when we met. I'll link that vlog down below. But Gabby convinced me to buy We Need to Do Something by Max Booth III. This is an isolated horror thriller where they're stuck in a bathroom because there's a hurricane, I think. Tornado. There's a tornado. The fact that it just takes place in the bathroom, I want to feel that like claustrophobia when I'm reading. So I'm excited to see where this story goes. And it's super short. I'll probably be scared shitless of tornadoes from now on. Unlike every other Midwestern who just goes out and watches them. That day, I also bought Uncanny by Junji Ito, which is his memoir. I got the only copy that they had that day. Like, are you fucking kidding? And the inside is like all blue and there are illustrations. A Stillbee said that there's like, ooh, in the corner, you can't really see. Yeah, in the corner, there's like flip animation. This is so hard to show. Ugh. Tomie on the back. I just love Junji Ito, as y'all know, so I can't wait to read his memoir. Hopefully I make this my December nonfiction. I gotta remember to do that. Oh my god, there's still piles behind me. This video is never gonna end. Next, I have Angels Before Man by Raphael Nicola. Never heard anyone talk about this besides Kat Karras. I don't even know if she finished it in that vlog, but it's a queer retelling of The Fall of Satan, and that is all I needed to know, my dudes. It's indie published. I don't know when I'm gonna read this, but it sounds so fucking good. Look at this cover. I should actually recommend this to Destiny. I feel like she'd like it. The next book I bought at the same horror bookstore the night we met CJ Lead. I got Necrology by Meg Ripley. This is a random one that I saw as an Amazon or Goodreads suggestion. It sounds kind of like Bunny, to be honest. I had to look. I was like, were there rabbit ears on the cover? In a fantastical aftermath of the Salem witch trials, magical women known as the Dirty have signed a contract swearing off their innate magic in exchange for freedom from violence by non-magical freemen. Sounds like there's going to be a lot of commentary on like misogyny, feminism, just being a woman in general, but make it kind of culty and witchy. And it's so cute. And it's one of those with like the spine on the cover, on the spine, spine on the spine. It's just like a square shaped book. The next one I have is Dear Dickhead. This is a translated novel. I believe it's in epistolary format. I bought this specifically for a video that may or may not come out this year, probably early next year. It's been simmering for the past year. I'll definitely be doing it. I'm not gonna say what it is. Some of my friends know, but eventually I'll get around to it. It's about a culture that makes men and women sick and about how the search for feeling leaves us addicted to what makes us feel. It just seems very meta and, again, raw and honest and unapologetic. So we'll be reading this and probably enjoying my time doing so. Another kind of weird lit fic is Brutes by Diz Tate. I've heard really good things about this. It says a fever dream of a novel which will transport you into the lip gloss slicked swamps of girlhood. I feel like this could be really relatable and take me back to like adolescent period and girlhood period, apparently. And I'm sure they talk about periods. Huddled at a bedroom window, a group of teenagers peer out at their scorched, swampy, fame-hungry town. Taking turns with the binoculars, their gaze sweeps across the highway and the abandoned construction site to the lake. Figures drift across the landscape. Mother's father's a preacher's daughter. These girls know everything about everyone, perhaps too much. So we're gonna learn people's deep, dark secrets, it seems like. Then we have Air by Saba Tahir. This is the Barnes & Noble exclusive edition. I haven't read Saba Tahir yet. I don't think. Did I? No, I don't think. But I have her Ember in the Ashes trilogy. There's no spredges. Ew, I just said spredges. There is a map on the end pages. There's a design on the front and a design on the back. It says an orphan, an outcast, a prince, and a killer who will bring an empire to its knees. I will tackle this when my brain feels up for it. Let's go to this pile behind me. We have a couple of Twisted Retreat books. We have Antenora by Dori Lumpkin. I heard this one's really good. I heard there's religious horror in this and it gets really relatable if you've experienced any religious trauma growing up. So it has a very gothic cover. I love the corners that they put. I love the snake on the back. Ooh, that crack. Oh, yes, yes. And it says, Dante's Ninth Circle of Hell reserved for traitors to their country. What really happened to Nora Willett? Religious community of Bethel. I'm excited for the shorty patorty. Tiffany read this and I forgot who, I'm sorry. Someone commented on one of my videos and they're like, hopefully you get more people to read this because it's apparently very underrated. So I'm excited for that. Yeah, Twisted Retreat had 2 books this past month, which by the way, I'm a rep for them now. Jan5 is my discount code. But Do What Godmother Says was the book this past month. By L.S. Stratton. Here's the naked cover. Oh my god, I forgot how pretty it was. I'm getting tired. A modern day writer and a Harlem Renaissance artist are connected by a painting with a deadly secret in this gripping dual timeline gothic thriller. I love anything with the word gothic in it. Okay, sue me. Guillotine, I already read, I've talked about. I will link my wrap up if it's up already and the vlog that I discuss this in. But this is by Delilah S. Dawson. This is a very Eat the Rich vibe. The menu meets Ready or Not is a very accurate comp for it, and I just watched Ready or Not for the first time, and I will agree with that comparison. Next, we have The Darkness Within Us by Trisha Levenseller. Joey convinced me to buy 3 special edition books off Pango. The Dagger and the Flame was one of them. This is the other one, and then we have A Dowry of Blood. You know what got me, though? Is this. Are you kidding me? The gold foiling. The bookish gal. I just don't like that the guy's blonde, but that's just me. We can look past it. Oh yeah, forgot about that. Yep, so gorgeous. I've read Daughter of the Pirate King and whatever the second book was, Daughter of the Siren Queen, I think. I really enjoyed her writing. It feels like just like classic YA, so I have high hopes for this one. My husband is taking too long to die, is all it says on the back. Oh, she dumbs herself down. Classic, classic move. Once her elderly husband dies, she will have all the freedom and money she's ever wanted. It kind of sounds like a B-plot in Bridgerton. If you know, you know. I got another edition of A Dowry of Blood, the Fairy Loot one. Are we surprised? I've been eyeing this, okay. It was about time. It was inevitable that I got this. This is my favorite book of all time, if you were unaware. If you're new here, hello, hi. I talk about this whenever I can. Polyamorous Vampires, Dracula's Brides, retelling, goes into the nitty-gritty, subtle intricacies of toxic relationships. Very relatable, very poetic lyrical writing. It's in second person. That's that. Next, we have Conversations with Friends by Sally Rooney. I've read this before, but it was a library copy, and I want to reread all of Sally Rooney's books eventually because I love Normal People. I just finished Intermezzo. This is, I think, the next one I want to reread, and then I want to watch the show. I mean, it's just your classic Sally Rooney book with messy people and universal truths. I think there's cheating in this, so beware of that if that's a trigger, but I could be mixing it up with Beautiful World, Where Are You? Because I know there is cheating in that for sure. My voice is disappearing. I'm so sorry. Next, we have Rewitched by Lucy Jane Wood. I know my friend Jody really loved this. This is another one that was on my wishlist since last year before it came out. And then I saw the cover when it released and I was like, oh yeah, yep, buying that. And then I forgot about it. And then I did buy it. And then Jody read it. It's like her favorite book of the year. So Belladonna Blackthorne is our main character and she's a bookseller. She's in her 30s and she's just like lost in life. I heard it's really relatable if you're also in the boat of not knowing what the fuck you're doing. And it's also in the setting of this like cozy, witchy fantasy type book. So I'm ready. I'm here for it. I thought we were almost done. We're not. Such a big book haul. What the fuck? I got the last Chestnut Springs book that I didn't have because I was nervous that this cover would sell out and wouldn't match the rest of my editions. Okay, listen. Sometimes you just gotta succumb to the consumerism. This is Hopeless. It's the outcast bartender and a shy girl from the wrong side of the tracks. Those are the tropes. Next, we have The Skunks by Fiona Warnick. I got this during the Chloe Gong event with one of my patrons from an indie bookstore. And this is another weird lit fic in this, like, I don't know, not traditional format, I guess, with all these vignettes. I've never heard anyone talk about this. I want to see for myself and go in blindly. I'm gonna be so honest with y'all that I just opened it and saw the format and I'm like, oh, it looks like We Spread and all the litfic books that I enjoy reading. I didn't even read the synopsis. Coming of age story about the complexities of crushes, desire, friendship, and modern life. There you go. Another edition of Dracula. The intermezzo launch party. I got these two from the indie bookstore that I was at. It's the, what are they called? The olive editions or something? Yeah, I just had to. I haven't read The Exorcist, but I have read Dracula and this is like my 16th copy. We're not gonna talk about it. Also from the Chloe Gong event, I got Through the Night Like a Snake. These are Latin American horror stories. The cover was really creepy and there were a couple authors that I recognized from this, so I'm excited. There's like red font in it sprinkled throughout. There's red story headings, so I thought it was a very well-crafted book. Another story collection, A Sunny Place for Shady People by Mariana Enriquez. I've heard mediocre things about this. I'm kind of nervous, but I love the cover. And have I read a Mariana Enriquez? I can't remember, but I own a few of her books now. Compound Fracture by Andrew Joseph White. This is the author of Hell Followed Us or something like that, and The Spirit Bears Its Teeth. But this is an Appalachian YA horror, and I read the first couple pages and the writing was beautiful, and there's a lot of commentary on coming out and being queer, and I love this freaking color, this olive green. Then there's those end pages, and I know there's like some history in this as well, so pick that up from Barnes & Noble, I think. Oh, also from the Chloe Gong event, Full Moon Coffee Shop by Mai Mochizuki, translated by Jesse Kirkwood. Just your classic Japanese translated book with a cat on the cover, you know, it's just cozy. Full Moon Coffee Shop. If that's not Jan Agaton in a title, come on, you're just missing vampires at this point. If you didn't know, my book club's called Full Moon Book Club. Did I mention that earlier? Probably. And I freaking love coffee, so I don't even know the premise of this book. Charming and magical novel reminds us that it's never too late to follow our stars. Like, how fucking cute. Cats are a symbol of good luck in Japan. If you are kind to them, they'll one day return the favor. A particular coffee shop is run by talking cat. Oh, so cute. We're not done yet. I'm gonna run out of storage. Okay, we have Outline by Rachel Cusk. I got this when I was on a roll with the 100 best books of the 21st century list, according to the New York Times. I've been wanting to read this anyway. My friend Sid read this and really enjoyed it, and I think it has good writing, I've heard. Very annotatable quotes. It's just a litfic about, I think it's this woman artist? No, that's a different book. It's a novel in 10 conversations. I love books with like quirky formats like that, you know? Portrait of the narrator is drawn by contrast, a portrait of a woman learning to face a great loss. And it's like a series of 3 books. Outline, Transit, and Kudos. And I just love how simple this cover is. I don't know, I did a really bad job doing that. Give me a break. I need water and I can't find it and I'm not getting up from the spot. So here is the edition of The Familiar that I got from Pango. This is the Illumicrate edition. I'm gonna reread it, so might as well get more editions, you know? From the Chloe Gong event, it was for Vilest Things. I did start Immortal Longings, haven't finished it yet. That's what the tour was for, and I wanted to hear her speak, so we went. This has like body jumping. I think it's considered urban fantasy, but it's inspired by Shakespeare's Antony and Cleopatra. Next we have In These Hallowed Halls. It's a dark academia anthology. There are stories by Olive E. Blake, ML Rio. I don't know any of these other authors. That was enough to get me to buy it because I love dark academia, and I was on a short story collection kick after watching my friend Noelle's big project video reading short story collection. Another Twisted Retreat book from a couple months ago now. Love the eyeballs on the stenciled edges. Love the eyeballs on the end pages. The front is very like Big Brother-esque to me. I don't know, but the other side, it looks like Dowry of Blood vibes. I do love the eyeballs though, and the back is my favorite part, these back end pages. I love this book, 5 stars. You've heard me talk about it before if you've been here for any amount of time. Then we have Stoner by John Williams, which is a classic. This was influenced by Bella from Throne of Pages. She loved this. She quoted some of the lines in here. It seems like it's a love letter to books and like learning, kind of, but also losing people you love. It just seems like it's gonna break my heart, and I'm excited. We have The Mayor of Maxwell Street by Avery Cunningham. Got this from Half Price Books. I don't know what made me pick this up because it's set in Chicago. It's a historical fiction. I don't read historical fiction too often, but I want to get back into it, and this sounded really good. It says the year is 1921 and America's burning. America's also burning now, so wow. Maybe this will be not too historical as we thought. A fire of vice and virtue rages on every shore, and Chicago is its beating heart. An epic love story. Oh, that's why, because there's a romance in it. A riveting historical drama and a brilliant exploration of Black society and perseverance when the 20s first began to roar. And the chapters are short, so hopefully this gets me back into my historical fiction mood. I try to avoid saying the word era. Lost in the Garden by Adam S. Leslie. Heard this is culty, heard this is very difficult to understand, so I'm scared of this book, but I'm willing to try to tackle it. It was just something everyone knew, a rule to be followed. Don't go to Almonby. I don't know what Almonby is, but this gives me Midsummer vibes, which I love. So that's what made me want that. Last two books! This is gonna be like a 2-hour video, but last two. We have And He Shall Appear by Kate Vanderborg. This is a dark academia. Haven't heard anyone talk about it. I just saw it as a suggestion on Amazon, I think. A story of obsessive friendship, chilling powers, and untimely death. It's set in Cambridge. It seems like it's one of those pretentious dark academia books, like Atlas Six type of vibe, with an obsession storyline. And the snake on the cover, oh my god. Yeah, I love a good obsession story, and then put it in a dark academia setting. Sold. Last book is a Fairyloot edition once again. This is Drown Me With Dreams by Gabby Burton. This is the sequel to Sing Me To Sleep. Oh my god, they're so cute. And I love Sing Me To Sleep. I have good memories with that book because I read it on my birthday and it was 5 stars. So I had to get the matching edition, and it's just a duology, and it's called the, oh no, that's not what it's called. I don't know what the series is called, but it's YA. There are sirens, there are secrets, there's a romance, there's a sister relationship that's really prominent in it. I'm excited to see where the story goes and how it all ends. Yeah, okay, I'm done. That was a lot. That was a lot longer than I wanted to film. It's now, oh my god, it's now 3 o'clock. I've been filming for over an hour, way over an hour, almost 2 hours. Oh my god, okay, I gotta go. If you made it to the end of this video, let's put the dagger emoji in the comments down below to represent the dagger and the flame, because I'm really excited for that book. Once again, thank you to anyone who's ever gifted me anything. Thank you for watching this video. Hope you had a 5-star day. Don't forget to do some self-care, and I'll see you in my next one. Bye.